Hi, I'm Chris.
And I'm Wendy.
And welcome to the Toasted Marshmallow Adventures podcast. Today in the studio, we've got Ian O'Connor.
Yay. Welcome.
Say hello.
Thank you for joining us.
Thank you. Now, Ian and I, we work together at Intermountain Hospital. I think you're on a different schedule now because I don't see you much anymore.
Yeah, we're on opposite ends.
Oh, you're on the end of the week now.
But I'm picking up, like, I'm going to be picking up a lot. Ski season's coming, so.
Yeah. Definitely all about ski season. Sweet.
Get to embrace it.
Yeah, no doubt. Before we get started, first of all, we'd like to actually thank all of our listeners.
Yes, thank you.
Yes, everyone. Yay! In Idaho.
In India.
India, yeah. We have a lot of people in India now, which is crazy.
No shit.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I put our podcast on this. It's like India's number one podcasting platform called Ghana, and I have more listeners in India than Idaho right now. So
we put out a post and we got 5,300 likes.
Mm-hmm. That's dope. That's insane.
Yeah,
we're lucky to get like four.
Yeah. So. And that's Instagram as opposed to Facebook too.
Yeah, true.
So we ran an ad on Instagram. The ad got 5,300 likes. On Facebook, it got 100.
Yeah.
So,
I think more. Instagram's probably like, I think people just scroll through Facebook too much.
I think so.
And there's just so much other stuff like on there. Like Instagram, I feel like you can just like scroll down that.
Exactly.
And like you'll see everything that's posted pretty much.
Yeah. And Instagram seems to be
more positive.
Yeah. Less negative.
Yep.
Dude, I got off I'm not even off Facebook completely. I like got rid of the app and I don't really check it that much anymore.
It's so negative. Like,
shit's good.
Yeah.
I don't, it's bad. It's not a good time to be on Facebook. I don't know. I mean, I have my opinions on Facebook, but I don't think it's, I don't know. I'm just glad I'm not on it.
Yeah.
100% right now.
Yeah. We pretty much just use it for business now and that's it. And it doesn't do a lot for that, honestly.
Nope. No, it doesn't. Yeah.
No, it's very emotionally fueled, I think.
Yeah.
I agree.
Exactly. Yeah.
So we've got enough of that.
Mm-hmm. We're good.
Yeah. So we asked you to come over because I wanted to do an episode on like hiking and backpacking.
Sure.
That kind of stuff. And you're one of the people I know that does that shit a lot. So let's talk about. First of all, like when did you start hiking as a kid or backpacking?
Well, I've always like I grew up like going camping and like we would go to McCall a lot and like Joseph, Oregon when I was a kid. And back then in the 90s, like McCall, and I haven't been to Joseph. I was actually gonna go there this winter, but I haven't been to Joseph in a while, but I've been to McCall recently, and it was a different ball game back in the 90s when I was going there. Still nice. But we grew up doing that. I would go with my dad, my older brother, my younger brother, my mom. And eventually, like, we stopped going as much. I wanted to go every weekend, but my dad was a nurse, my mom was a nurse, and they worked weekends every now and then, so it just didn't happen. Okay. As I got older, I got more into, you know, just hiking around here. I've done a lot of the trails here in the Boise area, and a lot of them, like, it's insane how far some of them go up that people don't know about. But yeah. Anywho, after I turned 18, when I was 16 and 17, I was drinking a lot and I was smoking a lot of weed, doing a lot of mushrooms, and I don't do that anymore. I got sober when I was like 17, 18, and right when that happened, that's really when like it started to take off for me, because I had a mountain bike, and seeing how I wasn't drinking, I could get up early and go mountain bike. I could get up early and go hike. Like, I could go hike without taking a bunch of fucking mushrooms.
Right.
It wasn't as fun sometimes. Like, I don't know if I got as much out of it, but at the same time, like, it was still really nice.
Yeah.
But that's really when I kind of got into it. And that's when I started just, you know, going off by myself. Kind of a dumb decision now. I'm really reluctant to do it now. But I would go off by myself and just hike up some random trail. Or I would just, you know, leave the trail and hike up and down the mountain.
Wow. Mm.
And that's really how I got the passion for it, and how, you know, I can appreciate, like, not necessarily just like the end of the trail, like the lake or whatever is there, but I can appreciate that entire journey, even if it makes my legs burn, even if I, you know, soak my shoe in mud or cow shit or something like that. Like, I have a full appreciation when I can, kind of rough it and see it through, if that mm-hmm. makes sense. And those yeah. are the ones that I remember. I mean, some of the best ones I've had have been, you know, up off a Lucky Peak mm-hmm. to the left in the wildlife management area, just because you see so many deer and not a lot of people hike up there because it's so mm-hmm. hot. So oftentimes mm-hmm. I found that, you know, if I'm embracing the elements, whether it's cold or whether it's heat, I'm going to have a better experience.
Oh, really?
So far. Oh, yeah. I mean, you just see less people.
Yeah, I see. Yeah.
But it's definitely given me a way to kind of have some inner peace. It's given me a way. I don't like running. I mm-hmm. hate running. It's given me a way to get some cardiovascular yes. energy.
Yes, we hate running, too.
It sucks.
Yeah, it does.
But it's given me an opportunity as well. Like, I mean, when I was like 18, 19, making $7 an hour, working 20 hours a week, driving a Wagoneer that got 6 to the gallon, like, I couldn't really afford to go skiing. But we yeah. got so much snow that year that I was like, well, I know all these trails in the foothills, and I was actually able cool. to park and just ski down the mountain.
Wow.
And
that's awesome.
Yeah, I mean, I liked it. So, I mean, that's, I don't know, there's just, I could go on and on about like everything that it's done for me, but I mean, I think most of all, it's like, you know, it gives me something to do. I don't have to spend a lot of money doing it, and mm-hmm. I always get some sort of meditation and some sort of exercise when I hike.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And you know, if I don't want to see people, which oftentimes I don't after a few days of working in our line of work, like,
mm-hmm. yeah.
it's perfect.
Yeah.
It's great.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's true.
Now, you've told me about, you've done solo trips, right? Like backpacking trips?
Oh, yeah. I love solo trips.
Yeah. We've talked about that. We're like, I don't think we could do it.
Did Chris like, tell too much you how
solitude. It-
How terrified we were two nights in the wilderness.
What happened?
Terrified. Things were brushing against our little two-person tent. We were at tent.
Jenny Lake. It's off of 21 yeah, there yeah. by Whoop 'em Up
yeah.
campground. So we hiked to that. It's like 5 miles uphill. And at night, you know, and I brought my tablet. We had the office downloaded. We wanted to have like our luxuries of home, I guess, you know. And so, and then it also added to, you know, cut out the silence of the forest, which, you know, to us is can be
it creepy, was pretty so. Terrifying yeah
silent. It's crazy how like
stuff is touching our tent because like, is that a bear? And I'm like, I think it's a deer.
Scary silences sometimes. Yeah. You know, yeah. Yeah, like shit. And so we're at this campsite at night, we're laying in the tent, and you know, we hear something brush the tent, and Wendy thought, you know, I had moved, and I hadn't moved at all, and something was outside of our tent and brushed it, and we were scared shitless. Yeah. I was like, well, fuck it, I'm going to sleep, hopefully I'm alive in the morning. But you stayed up all night because you were scared.
I did, yeah.
Yeah. Brutal. So yeah,
so you apparently don't have that issue.
It depends.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
I'm trying to think. The first time I camped solo, where I parked my car and I just walked and I pitched my tent, I did have that issue. Like, I was freaking out. Like, I think there was like a chipmunk or a deer, and I didn't know like what the fuck it was. So I just assumed the worst.
Or a mountain lion.
Yes.
Or like a mountain lion, which like we all have like the I think we all have like the negativity bias where we all want to assume it the goes most, to the like, very the worst. Worst. Mm-hmm. But first night that I was there, I think I took a Dramamine, or I took like a Benadryl.
Oh,
and I was okay. like, you know what, like, because I know like deep down inside that like I had this feeling deep down inside that like it was probably a chipmunk, because I had my dog with me. He's half terrier. Like, he would have barked if it was something else. So I was like, you know what, screw it, I'll go to bed. I slept like a baby, and then I woke up, had some lamb chops that I cooked on a rock.
Nice.
Super good. And then like that was that. I think the first I went with a couple of friends, and like these are like they're good friends of mine, like I have a lot of respect for them, but like we do things differently when it comes to outdoors. First trip that I went out with them, like I was sick at the time, like my stomach lining was eroding, and I was just getting better, like I was just able to start eating stuff again and like be active, and I was pumped, like I wanted to go. And we went up to Queens River, which is kind of up by Atlanta. Super gorgeous mm-hmm. area. Like, it's fucking dope up there.
Okay, I remember this time.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. I think I told you when yeah. I came. I think I was pissed coming back. I'm like, because we were hiking, and we encountered water because it was runoff. It was like May.
Yeah.
And they were saying, oh, we don't want to hike through this, it's too wet. And I'm just standing here like 3 miles in, like, are you fucking kidding me?
Yeah. Yeah.
You is this me. What's happening? But we went back and we camped. And the next trip that I decided I was going to take, I'd always wanted to go down to Great Basin National Park in Nevada outside of Ely. Mainly because I've driven that road like a bunch growing up, like going down to Vegas, going to Arizona. And there's not a whole lot down there. But it's a really nice drive getting there. A lot of deer, a lot of elk, and a lot of good scenery off in the distance. So I went down there, and first night I did by myself that Teresa Lake. And it wasn't like... It looked like the Sawtooth. I mean, it was green. Okay. There's pine trees. Like, it was high altitude. I mean, you can actually drive up 10,000 feet.
Dang.
And, like, I drove up 10,000 feet, walked, I think, 2 or 3 miles, called it good, woke up, walked back to the car, and then I drove down, waited out a thunderstorm, and I did this one trail, which is kind of off to the side, off this dirt road. There's only, like, 2 cars. Like, for a national park, like, nobody's fucking there, and it's fucking sick.
Wow. Mm.
Like, and it's dope. Mm-hmm. But so it was the South Fork Baker Creek Trail, and I just remember, like, started hiking. Like, you're still in the desert when you're hiking. You're still having, like, the tall sagebrush. On the other side of the loop, it wasn't really a loop, but on the side that I came down, there's actually cactuses. But when I was walking up, I didn't see the cactus. But it's super cool. It was the most amazing hike that I've done, because you start out in the desert at like maybe 4,000 feet, 4,000 or 5,000 feet, and you're going up to like 12,000, 11 Dang. Or 12,000. And it's like, it's literally like walking up an embankment for the first, you know, 2-3 miles, and it's an 8 mile trail. So I'm walking up this, and I go from, you know, being in the desert to being in like trees, like not even aspen trees yet, but like just a lot of the trees like we'd see around here, like mm-hmm. maple or like trees, like deciduous trees.
Mm-hmm.
And walk through another thunderstorm before I started climbing this main hill. And then you're getting into the sagebrush, and you're getting into the stuff that we see around, you know, this part of Idaho. And you keep going. Then you get into this field of aspen trees for like maybe 2 miles. And it's the craziest thing ever, because all these cutouts on these trees look like eyes, and they're looking at you. It's the creepiest, really? Creepiest thing. It's the coolest thing ever.
Oh, wow.
But I kept hiking up, and eventually towards the top, it gets really, really steep.
How was your breathing?
I was.
Were you feeling it?
Oh, I was feeling it for sure.
Oh, okay.
I acclimate. If I'm hiking, I can acclimate really well to the altitude.
Mm-hmm.
If I just like take a train or like fly to high altitude, I'm fucked for like an hour.
Oh yeah.
But with this, like, you know, I kept hiking. I was waiting to see like a mountain lion or something like that. The only animals I saw were turkeys and some mule deer. And the mule deer there are like the size of the elk that we see up here. Whoa. In the winter. Like, they're huge.
Wow.
Eventually I ran into a guy from Georgia who was hiking with his family. Made it up to Baker Lake, and the thing about Baker Lake is it's the quietest place you'll ever go to. It's comparable to like putting in earplugs and then like putting on noise isolating headphones like these.
Wow.
Yeah.
And it's a trip. But I remember sitting there, like, I got up there, like, I picked some berries from a bush, and I was sitting filtering the water out of the lake, and there's this huge, like, it's like a half circle of a wall, and it just straight up, almost like it's like deeper than the Snake River Canyon, it seems like.
Wow. Mm.
And like, that was the view for the night. That's what I was waking up to. And then the next morning I was going to climb up Wheeler Peak, which is 13,000 feet.
Dang. Mm.
Got a little interesting the next morning though. Next morning I woke up, and this lake, by the way, too, like, I wish I would have gotten a fishing license or like brought my rod, because you'd see the fish jumping, like decent sized fish. They would jump so much you would think it's raining.
So
I ate my oatmeal, my pasta that night when I could have had like trout.
Yeah.
You know, that's a lot fucking better.
Sheesh.
But woke up, I went to go filter some water, and I at the time I thought my water filter had broken, because that water tasted like straight mud.
It was lake water.
It was lake water.
I remember you telling me about lake water.
It was so fucked, like,
yeah.
So I like filtered a little bit, and then I like boiled I boiled like a small Nalgene of it.
Mm-hmm.
And packed all my shit up in my pack, and I was like, cool, I'll go this way and I'll hike up the mountain. and then I'll filter water from the spring. Cause there's like a spring every mile there. Like it's pretty much like, it's as green as like Multnomah Falls once you get back in those mountains. Mm. So you're never short on water. Well, I keep hiking. I made the decision not to climb up the mountain, but I took another way down where I kind of like, not necessarily scaled the ridge, but where I walked the ridge down. And as I'm walking the ridge down, like I kind of see where the path starts to connect. And I follow this path down. About 2 miles down, I'm like drenched in sweat. I'm feeling it. I'm waiting to see a stream or somewhere I can filter. And I come across a stream in what looks like a snow measurement area. So I stop. And I dropped my water filter somewhere over the last 3 miles.
Oh.
And I had maybe a little bit of water, probably about that much.
Wow.
In like this hydration pack from, I think I bought it at the co-op for like 50 cents. So I drank it I drank it slowly as I went down. I mean, I tore apart my backpack, like my sleeping bag was unraveled. And I was just like, well, fuck, like, I guess my option is, I guess I'm going to suffer.
Yeah. So,
yeah.
Kept walking down, and eventually, like, it was so crazy walking down this side of it, too, because the first side was almost all forest coming up. And this other side, I mean, you walk through an area that was destroyed by an avalanche, but you also walking down, like, all these cool rocks, like, into this really, really lush green area across, like, these logs. It looked like a mountain biking park, really.
Oh, cool.
But made it down the 8 miles, and the only thing that really kept me going is I knew I had like 2 gallon jugs of water in the trunk of my car.
So you were pushing for that.
Yeah. I mean, like, I knew, like, I just figured it's like, I'm not gonna.
Yeah.
But at the time I was 100, I think I was maybe 140, 150 pounds. Mm-hmm. Wasn't in shape, hadn't worked. Done any sort of like leg exercise, anything like that. So I was
how much does your pack weigh?
My pack that was 50 pounds.
Oh,
dang.
It's gone down since, but it was like 50 pounds.
Our Jenny Lake trick.
Yeah, we're pounds. At like, we're like, oh. 40 or 50.
Yeah.
I mean, nowadays I'd welcome the 50 pounds. But
really?
That trip, and it was my first, like, I think that was my second backpacking trip too.
Yeah.
And I don't know, like, I made it down, I drank the water. I mean, I was practically delirious by the time I was down there, like.
Yeah. Well, the crazy thing is, I think I kind of mentioned this trip to you, and you were like, why aren't we doing this? And that's actually what got us to buy backpacking gear and to do a couple trips ourselves. Yeah.
Thank you, Ian. So,
yeah. I remember that specifically.
I don't know. I still, like, that's probably one of the best trips I've been on. I mean, getting off that mountain, like, all I knew is that I just wanted to go eat a hamburger and get some Gatorade.
Yeah.
And I sat at the lodge, or not the lodge, but the little visitor center.
Where at?
At Great Basin. There's a little visitor center. I got a Gatorade and I was sitting there drinking it. Then I hobbled back to my car.
Yeah.
Drove into Ely and was like, well, I'm going to camp somewhere by a hot springs tonight. And, you know, ADD got the best of me that day, and I got sidetracked a bunch. So it was 5 o'clock by the time I got into Ely. I bought a hamburger and I was just gonna camp outside of Wells at this hot springs.
Mm-hmm.
So by the time I get to Wells that night, Wells is a fucking shithole. Like, Wells is fucking rough. There's some cool stuff around Wells, but like the town itself, like,
yeah.
And by this time, like, I was fully like feeling like super sick. Like, I had the headache bordering the migraine, like the nausea bordering the vomiting.
Dang.
Like, I was just tired, like I just didn't fucking care. And got to Wells and I'm like, fuck, I really don't want to walk my shit into a campground. And I drove around looking for a hotel and I'm like, fuck, I don't want to park my car anywhere in this town. Like, it's too sketchy.
It's like that kind of a town.
I mean, I think I stopped at Dunkin' Donuts, which is like one of the only good things they have going for them other than the Eastern.
It apparently is now only called Dunkin'. They dropped the donuts. I just heard that.
Really? Okay. I haven't heard that.
It's always going to be Dunkin' Donuts to me.
It's just Dunkin' now.
Apparently. Why? I think that's so stupid. I don't know. No, they still do.
What the fuck?
Yeah. Dunkin'. Anyway. Stupid.
Okay. So you're in Wells.
I'm in Wells and I'm like, well, fuck, do I drive Jackpot? And I love to gamble too. So like, I didn't want to drive to Jackpot because I knew if I stayed there, like, I would go gamble and I would sit at that table feeling like shit, and then I would feel like even more shit when I walked back to the hotel room at 4 a.m.
Yeah.
With less money.
Yeah. Less money. Yeah. Probably would have smoked cigarettes. And I was like, well, screw it. I'm just going to drive to fucking Elko. I'm 60 miles and I'll shoot up through a Waihee and not McDermott, but I think it's like a Waihee in one of the reservations there. I fished there. Good fishing, by the way. But I stayed there, got up, still had a couple days. So I drove to, I didn't get to hike because I was still sick, but I just drove up Lamoille Canyon and it's like something out of the Swiss Alps.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Oh, or the Bavarian Alps, I should say. Like, there's nothing else really like that I've seen in this area. Just the way the gorge is carved, the craggy mountains, the fact that it was July and it was like 40 degrees up there when the sun was fully out. And it wasn't super crowded. So hung out around there for a little while, and then I decided, well, I'm just going to drive back and I'll probably stop some spots along the way, take some pictures, and you know, that was that for that trip.
Mm-hmm.
But that whole fucking drive back was like some of the prettiest areas that I've ever seen.
Wow.
So I plan on getting down there. I was going to go down to the Indian Reservation, the Duck Valley, and fish, because their fishing's tremendous there, but they've been closed because of the coronavirus.
Yeah.
So I haven't been able, which is, it's bittersweet. You know, the fish are just going to get bigger, but
yeah,
I mean, it just kind of made it back and came back to work. And like from that day forward, I was like, yeah, I really like doing this.
Yeah.
Not so much the feeling sick part, but like
just being out
and doing that, because
in the middle of nowhere,
having that peace, I'd never heard peace and quiet like that. And I've been to a lot, like the only time I've heard peace and quiet and like that is being out in the snow.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Have you been to Alaska?
Not yet. I'm actually going to go there next.
Nice. Yeah. Alaska has that kind of quiet.
I like that kind of quiet.
Yeah. Yeah. Where are you going?
I'm not sure yet.
Oh, cool.
I'm broke right now, so I'm just kind of working extra.
Like, yeah.
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 Reevaluate in a couple months.
Yeah.
Now when you go backpacking after doing it a number of times, I mean, are you like an ultralighter?
No, I don't know. I've kind of like still like stuck to my guns on the fact that like you don't need to spend a fortune to go backpacking. There's a lot of people, like, and I think Instagram and Facebook are to blame sometimes, but there's a lot of people who, you know, when they get into backpacking, they'll go to REI and they'll let the employee at REI, whoever's selling on the bag, pack their backpack. And what happens when you do that is you spend $2,000-$3,000 and it's not necessary. I would like to get into ultralight at some point when I get older, but right now, like, I'm probably in the best shape that I've been in. Strongest I've been, like, I have a decent diet, like, I don't smoke, I don't drink, don't do drugs anymore, like, shit's good. So I'm gonna keep doing this until I can't do it.
Yeah.
But I do like my backpack to weigh around like 30 to 40 pounds.
Dang.
I mean, 30 pounds for like an overnighter or two-nighter, but like 40 to 45 if I'm going to do more than that, which I haven't had the chance to do that because every time I go, I get sick.
Yeah.
But I do, I just kind of play it by ear. You know, like some days sometimes I'll bring a jar of peanut butter and I'll bring like bread and bananas.
Yeah.
Right? Like,
and that's awesome.
You know, like other times, like, it's frowned upon by a lot of people in backpacking.
Yeah.
Exactly. Or like bring something. But other times, like, I'll bring the MREs and like the backpacking food that I can, you know, fit in any nook and cranny, that, and I'll kind of go with that.
Yeah.
But yeah.
I play things by ear a lot.
Yeah. We did actually, I don't think we did any MREs. I bought some.
We ate them at the house.
We did. Oh.
I like MREs. I think they're good.
I don't think I've ever actually had one. We have some, but I've never actually...
No, we did that thing.
Oh, we did that one that has the self-heating thing to it. It was like beans.
It wasn't bad.
Yeah, it wasn't too bad. And then...
We brought way too much shit, though.
We brought... Yeah, well, because we tried to plan it out accordingly, like breakfast, lunch, dinner, maybe like a little snack here and there.
We were like,
we came back with like half of our food. Yeah. And so we're just carrying all this extra weight with us.
Yeah.
Now, do you bring a luxury item with you at all?
I'll bring like a pair of headphones, but I've ran into some like mountain lions and like some bears before, so I don't like wearing the headphones. And
yeah,
I mean, like, if I'm like walking through the desert, I will, like, foothills, but if I'm like up in the sawtooths or like in some nooks and crannies,
you
like
be I'll able just to hear.
Yeah, I mean, I'll bring my phone or I'll bring a camera generally to take pics, but I strongly do not believe, I mean, to each their own, I'll say that first, but like, you know, it's gotten to the point hiking around some spots, the sawtooths, where you'll hear somebody's, you know, fucking Bluetooth boombox from 2 miles away because they feel that
everyone needs to hear it.
The middle of the middle of the lake is where that is where they need to.
Yeah, I totally disagree.
Yeah, like,
that's why we're here. We want to get away from that here. Shit.
Yeah, I mean, I'll listen to music when I hike, but like, I don't know. I'm just not real big on that, but. If I'm going to bring anything luxury, it's going to be like luxury food. And I see it because, you know, I've hiked with a lot of people who they insist on bringing like the minimum, but at the same time, like, I don't know. I like lifting weights. Like I like fitness. And when you do that kind of stuff, like you have to really take into account what you eat and how much you eat.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that walking up and down mountains requires a lot of fucking carbs. Yeah. Like you watch some of these through hikers, like on Instagram, and they're eating Skittles the entire day just because that's just their body, like they've burned all their fat.
Wow.
So they can't like they're not getting their energy from that, and they're doing that. So I mean, I won't eat like Skittles all day, but like, you know, I'll pack a box of Nutty Bars, or like I'll pack like pack some candy bars, I'll pack the highest carbs. I mean, I want to be eating close to like 600 grams of carbs that I'm backpacking. But unfortunately, the way it goes half the time with that and with how I get when I get so exhausted is I don't want to eat a thing.
Yeah.
So I'll come back and I'll eat the Nutty Bars next week. You know, or I'll bring them to work or something like that.
Yeah.
Nutty Bars. I love those.
That's how it was when we did Jenny Lake.
Yeah, like, we hardly ate.
We were exhausted. Like on the trail when you're doing, you have like 40 pounds on your back and it's uphill the whole way, you don't really feel like eating. Mm-hmm. But
no,
by the time we got to our destination,
you were like white.
I was actually sick.
Yeah.
It was like, I was pale. Like I needed calories.
Well, the thing about it too is it's like, I didn't even think about it until now, but I mean, I would think you almost want to bring like, not like pure sugar. I mean, you obviously want to bring like your hydration tablets, but I mean, if you're hiking straight up, like, your abs are going to be so sore and they're going to be pressing against everything on your stomach. So, I mean, it makes sense why you can't eat a lot, but at the same time, it's like, I find myself force feeding myself half the time.
Yeah. And it's just like, you got to just pack in like your, like macros, proteins, fat and carbs.
Yeah.
So
it's a free for all though. I mean,
I guess, if you're burning so many calories from hiking, you know, it's not like being here and just going to work and, you know, where I can't eat a fucking carb or I gained 10 pounds, you know, from eating 5 grams of carbs.
Yeah, I mean, out there, like, I don't know, we used to chew tobacco and I used to do that on the trail too as I got into higher altitude. I don't do it anymore, really. I mean, every now and then I will, but when I did do that, I would notice it was like constant, like I was just constantly awake.
Oh, and yeah.
That was nice.
Yeah. Chewing tobacco.
But at the same time, it's like I don't really eat that much when I chew. So it's kind of like, it'll keep you awake, but like you're going to end up feeling like shit regardless. So it's just better to like not do that, I guess.
Yeah.
But yeah, I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I like going up there and that's pretty much bring whatever.
Now I remember one trip you were telling me about that, and I don't remember, I think it was in Nevada, and you were talking about how you, I think, went to a certain elevation and like acclimated yourself so you could go up higher as far as oxygen level. Do you remember that trip? I think it was in Nevada.
It probably was, because like I've done, I mean, it was either there or the sawtooths, because I know, I think it was, no, it was the sawtooths, I think.
Was it? Oh, okay.
Yeah, it was Alpine Lakes. Sawtooth Lakes. I did Sawtooth Lake when I was younger, and it wasn't even an issue, but last time I did it, I just remember, like, because you get to the spot where you have a bird's eye view of Alpine Lake below you, and I just started getting the headache, the nausea, so you chill 10-20 minutes and you keep going and eventually you make it up to the top.
And do the symptoms get worse when you go, or it abates?
You have to, depends on how I acclimate. Like if I stay for a little, like if I chill, I think I actually did do it where I was at Nevada, because I was going from so low to so high. I just do it. I do it wherever. I mean, like if I'm going above 9,000 feet, if you, I found that if you rush things, like if I rush things, then I will feel like shit with that. But, and I'm really sensitive to it. Some people can go up to like 15,000 feet like that. Dang. Like some people can sprint up that shit. I don't know how, but you know, I just find that when I, if I acclimate myself, I'm good. And I had the same, when I was in Switzerland last year, I mean, we took a train up to 13,000 feet. And it took us maybe 20 minutes to get up there. And I just remember getting off the train with my dad, and I was like clutching all the handrails. Like, oh, I was like,
and how was your dad? Was he fine?
He was the same. He was like, fuck, I don't know if I'm going to like
pass out,
puke or pass out.
Dang.
But I mean, it was cool, but yeah, it was rough getting used to it. <That's for sure. laughs>
Sheesh. All right. Tell us about your best backpacking trip.
That's a tough one, honestly. Like, I would have to say probably the most recent one I did, and it wasn't even that long. Like, I literally just, so that when I go, like, it's bad because I should tell people like where I'm going and stick to that, but I never fucking stick to it. Yeah. I like see something like, oh cool, I'm gonna go up there.
Yeah.
So everybody knows about the Alice Toxway Loop. I went that way, but I went to Farley Lake, stayed a night there, and then the next day hiked up to Edith Lake. I think I did like 15 miles a day.
Wow.
It was just me and my little Jack Russell pug. And we just hiked up, and hiking up to Edith Lake though is probably like, that reminded me of like some of the stuff you'd see in like the eastern part of the Sierras, like just sheer like rounded granite walls, like you could walk up it like it was sidewalk.
And, wow.
You know, you're sitting at this lake, like the storm's coming in, the clouds are all crazy, and you're looking at the fish in this lake, and they're like black, like I didn't even know what kind of fish they were, but
were you the only one there?
There was a couple other people there. But it was just me backpacking solo. Saw some animals, saw some elk, didn't see any bears. But I think that one, I mean, I after that I walked down from Edith past a Farley Lake where I was at the night before, and walked into McDonald Lake, which McDonald Lake, like it's like a 3 mile hike from like a parking lot. I didn't know that at the time. It was, I just saw a sign that said it was 3 miles away, so I went there and like camped there, and it was like,
you're like, all right.
It was like something you'd see like literally like out of the, not necessarily like out of the Swiss Alps, but like out of like the Alps somewhere, like in Germany, where it's just, you have this green field, you have a lake, and then you just have like super like rocky crags on the other side of it. Huh. And you had the reflection coming down on it, and it like, the mosquitoes were outrageous, but yeah, I mean, it was nice. I don't think like the destination necessarily makes a trip the best or the worst. I think it's more like the attitude and like going into it. I mean,
oh, nice.
So like that, like it's like you get in that zone where you literally, you're hiking, you're exhausted, you know, you're like a mile or two out, but you have that little bit of curiosity where you're like, well, I feel like shit, like I probably shouldn't do it, but fuck it, I'm gonna keep doing it, you know. Right. like you're driving up in the mountains like that right there, that's where Edith, that's Edith Lake, that's,
oh, nice.
So
wow,
I think it's more about the mindset and like how you come out of it, because I mean I've hiked around, I think I've hiked around the Southeast when I was younger. I know I've been to some spots around there, and I've hiked around California a little bit when I was there. I've hiked in Hawaii a little bit. And like, they're all like gorgeous places, right? Like hiking to the edge of the cliff in Hawaii and seeing the ocean and the waves, like that's about as good as it gets. But I knew what I was going to see when I got there.
Right.
And I knew it was going to be cool.
Yeah. It is different.
But at the same time, it's just like hiking into somewhere like Edith Lake and even Baker Lake in Nevada, where it's like, I don't know, like if I, because Teresa Lake, when I hiked in there, Teresa Lake was like a pond, probably like the size of the, you know, it was tiny. And I was like, well, this is fucking stupid, but You never know what you're getting into. So I think when you go up there and you get into something that's great, then that's just, that's
amazing.
Yeah, that's what makes it for me. Or if you see like an animal.
Yeah.
Yeah, we've seen some awesome scenery. Well,
we saw a moose.
Oh, yeah, in McCall just like a month ago.
I believe it.
Yeah, we saw a moose at Upper Payette Lake. I've got video of it. I'll drop it right here.
I've seen a couple I've seen one up in Bear Valley.
Oh, nice.
When I lived in Montana, they were like everywhere.
Yeah.
Like you'd have to avoid them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're huge animals.
Man. Yeah.
They are, yeah. We saw a bald eagle recently as well at Ponderosa. It was on a tree stump. Yeah. And the next day we saw that, do you know Snowden
Wildlife Sanctuary?
Up there, they actually had that eagle, apparently.
Oh, really?
It was a downed eagle. That's why it was, like, so low, just sitting there.
Because we were like, what is emaciated. An eagle doing on the rock? Aww. That's so
It was on
rare.
A tree stump. Yeah. We were just, like, driving right by it. And it was, like,
it was starving, for some reason. But they freed it. They let it go
a month ago or something. Healthy and let it go, yeah.
It's awesome.
Yeah, seriously. So is there a piece of gear you realize you didn't need?
Well, yes and no.
Yeah.
Like I say yes and no because every time I've went, there's always been a piece of gear that I didn't use, right? Like I packed an extra t-shirt for a pillowcase. If I've hiked 15 miles in a day, like I don't really give a shit about the pillowcase. You know, like,
yeah.
But there's always stuff that it's like, I hope I never have to use it when I go. Like, there's a first aid kit and, like, a trauma kit that I packed. I never want to use that.
Yeah.
Like, on myself. Like, if I have to, like, I know how to do it and, like, I'm prepared. Yeah. Like, I'm confident with that. Like, I can handle that.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, same goes for bringing a gun with. A lot of people...
Well, that's what I wondered. If you traveled with a weapon.
I do.
Yeah.
A lot of people don't like that. A lot of... And, you know, to each their own on their opinions. Yeah, like, I can see... But, you know, my thing with that is, like, I never want to use it. And if I'm sitting in a tent and there's something clawing at my tent trying to get in, like, I'm gonna have sausage in the morning.
Yeah.
Right? Like, I'm not going to use a bear spray in my tent where I can potentially, like, gas myself in. And then it's going to have sausage in the morning.
Yeah.
You know, like.
Yeah.
But at the same time, if I am in that position, like, you bet your ass I'm going to fire a fuck ton of shots elsewhere, or I'm going to do my best where I don't have to shoot it because I don't want to shoot the animal. Like, I don't want to deal with that. I don't want to put the animal out of its life. But I mean, I think ultimately, like, when it comes down to it, like, that's something that doesn't necessarily make me feel secure. Like, I'll still get anxiety when I hear something outside of my tent.
Mm-hmm.
But
yeah,
it's more of a reassurance that, like,
if something does happen,
like, this is what's going to happen and so it's going to suck.
Do you ever think about the people aspect of that?
Like people breaking in?
Just encountering crazy people recently.
I have, because I retrofitted and insulated my truck bed and built like an insulated box so I can sleep back there this ski season. I think I was telling you about it earlier. But I went up to a camped outside of Clear Creek outside of Loman, just off the road. I parked my truck at like midnight, crawled in the back with my dog, went to bed. But I thought about that because the main reason I got the shell and I insulated that is when I take road trips to like Portland and Salt Lake, or, you know, if I go down to Arizona, I'm not necessarily going to spend $100 on a hotel in the middle of nowhere. Like, I'll save the $100 and spend that in the city.
Yeah.
Get a nice room, continental breakfast, like live well while I'm in the city.
Right.
But there always is that issue, especially where it's like, I mean, you never know. Like, last thing I would want is to wake up to somebody like trying to fuck with me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it reminds me too, because I remember when I first started working with Chris at Intermountain, we have a nurse, Ben, who works there.
Ben, yeah.
Somebody, he has a camper shell in his truck, and someone actually crawled in his shell while he was at work, and we stopped at the stoplight.
Oh, really?
The guy got out of his truck and ran away. Yeah.
Wait, what? Let's explain that a little bit more, because I haven't heard this story.
I feel like that would only happen to Ben.
yeah. She's met Ben.
So he parked, and this is just what he told me, and there's like a homeless guy.
This is at work or? Okay. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Crawled in his pickup. And then when he was at the barrister light, he said that somebody like crawled out of his truck and ran off.
Oh, shit. Like they're like,
like, oh, my bed's moving.
My bed's moving. Yeah.
So like,
oh, that's funny.
I mean,
that's
I'd worry about something like that. But I mean, the biggest thing for me is like, you know, if I'm driving back from somewhere at 2 a.m. and I need to pull over and sleep, like I'm probably not going to do it right off the interstate.
Yeah. And
I'm probably going to, I have 4-wheel drive. I'll probably use that to get me to a spot super remote. And then I'll hope that somebody's not up there and wanting to fuck with me. Yeah. But I think a lot of it too is your location. I mean, if you camp, if you're backpacking and you camp, you know, in an area where an animal has been hunted or where an animal has been killed, like you're setting yourself up.
Mm-hmm.
If you pull off of I-84 outside of Ontario or Baker City, and you just camp right there, like, I think you're setting yourself up. But luckily, I have my dog with me 90% of the time, so I'd know if somebody was trying to get in.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I mean, it could always happen. And I think some spots around here, I mean, you look at Grimes Creek, you look at places that are like Arrow Rock with how crowded it's getting and how the type of people that go up there these days, no offense to the people who are responsible and go up. There's a lot of irresponsible people that go up there and black out and, you know, use drugs and do all that. And I mean, there's a risk with that, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah. Definitely.
But sure. I've also camped up there a billion times and never had issues. So who am I to say what it's going to be?
Yeah. Now, do you carry, so when you're on your, when you're backpacking, and I probably already know the answer to this, do you carry anything that allows you to communicate with the, you know, civilization, like an inReach, by, you know, Garmin inReach or anything like that? Or you just,
I'd like to get one of those. I have my phone, and like, I know that if I'm like, if I'm going into the Sawtooths, like a lot of the times, like I'm not, unless I'm with somebody, I'm not gonna go run up a craggy mountain. Like I'll stick to the trail, and the trails are pretty well maintained in there.
Yeah.
If I sprain my ankle or something like that, like I can rely on my skills. Like I know how to make a splint. I know how to make the crutches. Like I know how to do wound care, do the tourniquets and all that. But no, I don't have like a rescue button.
Oh yeah. I know. Cause
when I got super messed, I know a lot of the peaks, if you go to the top of the mountain, you'll have service.
Oh dang.
Oh really? Mm-hmm. Okay. Gotcha. Yeah, I remember when I was in EMT school, I was talking to you, and you had been to EMT school, which are good skills to know.
They're fucking great skills to know.
Yeah. So, let's see. Oh, fucking Switzerland.
Yes.
Yeah.
Switzerland was dope.
Yeah. Amazing. That was earlier this year, right? Before COVID?
Yeah, it was like a month before COVID.
Yeah.
I actually think I got COVID.
Really?
In Switzerland?
Well,
fucking Switzerland.
I can't say for sure, but like there's a lot of Chinese tourists.
Yeah.
When I say
a
lot, I mean like fucking sardines, man.
Yeah.
Really? Wow.
And when were you there?
I was there in October.
Oh, okay.
But I remember coming back, and it was right around winter. I might have not even gotten it from them, but I came back. I think my dad might have gotten sick, but like I was sick and it felt like strep, and I was like, I felt like I was dying, and I like walked across the street to the urgent care, got tested. It wasn't strep. Nobody even heard about COVID yet. They just told me to go home, drink water. So I went home, drank water,
yeah,
drank some tea, and I was fine. But
wow.
Yeah, it was Switzerland was pretty sick. I wasn't there as long as I was in Germany, and I actually like Switzerland's got some pretty like insane like monumental areas. But
so how did you guys choose this area? Did it mean something to your dad?
It did. So like my dad, when he was my age, he lived out in Germany. He was in the army.
Oh, cool.
And he would drive around Europe and just check everything out. So he was my tour guide with that. He was probably the best tour guide that I could have. Oh,
that's
had.
The best.
Yeah, he knows his shit around there. He was patient with me and my jet lag.
Yeah.
But yeah, like if I went there again, I'd want to go with him just because
he knows.
He knows it. And like it was like he's super passionate about that. I mean, I can totally see that because I mean, when he was my age, like, I remember going to the train station in Munich in Germany, and like, he's just like, yeah, this place hasn't changed at all since the 70s.
And it,
like,
literally hasn't. No. Yeah, that's what's so wild.
Like, he, like, he's just really big into that kind of stuff. Yeah. And like, he's always been into that. He goes out there yearly.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so.
Is this your dad here?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Oh, yeah.
Is this in, oh, it's that's first in day Switzerland. In Switzerland. Okay, cool.
That's cool. Patagonia. Yeah.
So that was at the top of,
we'll put these pictures up
they
here.
They call it.
Is that me?
That's me, sorry. Oh. They call it the Harder Calm, but it's in between this place. It's in a place called Interlaken. So it's between two lakes, and the water is probably like, it's as blue as this water. Like, it's as blue as this. Oh, wow. Like, you look at it, and there's some pictures on there of it. But standing up there, you can see that whole valley.
Oops.
Wow.
And
those colors look fake. You know,
it's they do. So, that's the thing about it. Like, I just stared at the water. I'm like, it was such a trip. But so going up it,
those mountains.
I hiked up it one day, and it was probably the steepest hike that I've done. And the crazy thing about it up there is you don't see people tent camping like you do here. I mean, you would think that, like, you know, oh, it's the Alps, like, people are pitching all their tents, they're gonna sleep, but like,
no.
At least in Bavaria, there's shacks every 4 or 5 hours.
That's cool.
And they have, like, yeah, they got like restaurants and stuff, like sausage shacks, wow. Beer shacks.
On
the hike.
Whoa.
So you literally just go through that. But yeah, I mean, we stayed.
Wow. Look at those colors.
Yeah. It's crazy.
It's
oh, that was there.
So if you go down to the second one on the left.
Here?
Keep going to the right. That little house just below it.
Here?
Yeah. So that was the house. That's the rail that goes up, and it looks like something you'd see up Disneyland.
Really?
It's right here?
Yeah. And I think I have a video of like some of them in there. But if you are sitting on it, it literally looks like you're going up a roller coaster.
Oh, really? Wow.
And you're just being suspended by a little fucking cable.
And that's how you get to the house.
And that's how you get up there. And there's a trail that goes to the restaurant.
Whoa.
There's also a trail you can walk down to the bottom, which I did later on. It was a great hike. I mean, it's literally like the Appalachian Mountains and the Sawtooths, like, fucked in Connecticut. Like, that's literally, like, what it reminded me of.
Wow.
But some of the lower ones there, so that's in Germany. And I actually, like, Switzerland was awesome going to, but I think that...
His beard at some point.
I think that probably, like, going to, like, Europe, mainly, or not Europe, but, like, mainly, like, Bavaria and Germany is probably, like, the best one, like, the best... I mean, there's no other place like that. I mean, every building has the flowers out front, like the cobblestone sidewalk.
Everything's so cool.
It is so cool.
Yeah.
Like, the food is good. Yeah. The food is real. Yeah. Like, I mean, that's their artwork on their city hall. Like,
yeah.
On city hall. It's amazeballs.
And yeah. Like, Boise, like, we pride ourselves in the little fucking lawn chairs that we have out front. Like, that's like, I think that's a little more impressive.
Way more.
Yeah. That's, sheesh.
But I think the main takeaway from, like, going somewhere with Europe is, especially, like, Germany, like, where we were, is, I mean, it's a different lifestyle out there for sure. I think what we see here, like, we're so, as a society, and I could talk on this, it's a separate talk, I could talk on it all day, we're so anxious as a society.
Yeah.
We're so obsessed with ourselves, we're so obsessed with work, we're so obsessed with money, even though not a lot of us make a lot of money.
Getting things that we actually can't take with us anywhere. Like,
you see it there. I mean, like, we go out on a Sunday and you'd see families, like, with their 16, 17 year olds, like, just out hiking, like, hanging out. Like, you see, you don't see, like, it's not chaotic at night past 2, even though the bars are open. Mm-hmm. You know, like, you have the food that they serve there, it's all real. The soda, like, I bought an orange soda there out of the vending machine, and it was yellow because they don't allow certain preservatives there.
Yeah, like colorings and shit.
And, like,
an orange soda is yellow.
Nobody's fat there.
Yeah, like,
nobody's overweight.
Yeah.
Like, why did no one put orange coloring in this shit?
Yeah, I mean, it tastes like orange. Like, it was good. I mean, I was down with it, like, but
where's our orange number 14
in this shit in there?
Yeah.
Orange dye.
But it's one of those places, I think, where if you grew up like that, like, not to say everyone here has a shit lifestyle, but I think that they have done, just in terms of like development, like growing up, like health choices, like they've done very well.
Mm-hmm.
And that's despite having a cigarette machine in every corner, you know, like right. You still have the option.
Yeah.
Like, if you really want that, like, yeah, you can do
smoke
that.
Up.
Like,
cigarette yeah. machines. That goes oh, way wow. back.
Yeah. Cause you don't have those here no. anymore. They still have them no. in Switzerland, oh, the cigarette machine.
In Germany, they're like on every corner.
Wow. Really? Wow.
I wonder yeah. if that's where we sold all of ours to.
Maybe. Like, yeah. Cause I remember mean, that when I was a kid. Like,
everywhere
yeah.
there.
Wow. But,
the other thing about that going to Germany too is like you go out here to Starbucks, you get a cup of coffee. If you really want to wake up at Starbucks here, you have to get like a super tall cold brew. There, you get like they give you a shot and a cookie, and it's like crack.
Really?
You drink it in the morning, and like you're good to go for the day. Like there's no stopping.
Of course,
like,
my shot and my cookie.
Yeah.
Jeez. It's something else, but. The coolest, one of the other things about it too that I found was fascinating is like every tall mountain you could take a tram up to.
Oh, that's cool.
And like the yeah. trams were super intense going up because you're like, you're up, I mean, it looks like you're up 2,000 feet, like yeah. just looking down.
Yeah.
Like, it's insane. But once you're up there, you can kind of ski, like you can ski at the top of the Zugspitze, which was the highest point in Germany. And you can ski at the Alpspitz. The Alpspitz was, I think, the second highest point. But that was probably the coolest spot that I've been to there just because of the canyons you could hike
did
through.
You ski?
I didn't ski.
Oh,
there's shit. Snow, but nobody was skiing.
Oh, okay.
I did a lot of hiking there, and it's just, I don't know, it's just cool. Like, everything's so pristine there. Like, it's just clean. I mean, I don't...
Yeah,
I mean, you look at beautiful. The pictures there,
looks
it's like...
fake. It's so amazing.
You look at the rivers, like, they're... I mean, yeah, that was the Partnot Gorge hiking through that.
Wow.
That was sick. That was only like a 2 mile hike, but I mean.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Yeah.
Wow.
This is the scenery there.
And I never realized it about Germany, but it's super religious there.
Oh, really? I wouldn't have thought
what
that
religion?
Either.
I think it's Catholicism. Like you, I mean, there's churches. I mean, obviously there's churches and like. A lot of different places there, but you'll be driving places and like just random spots on the side of the road or on the mountain, there's some sort of like statue of like a
oh.
priest or someone from, I'm not really religious, so I don't know
no.
who they are, but like that cross right there.
Oh yeah. Huh.
This is in Germany here?
Yeah, so that's in Garmisch-Partenkirchen. That's where they had the Winter Olympics a few years back.
Oh, okay. What is this here?
I couldn't figure it out. That was on just below the Alpspitz, though. So if you took that lift up, it would take you to the very top.
This here?
Yeah.
Okay.
Wow.
Where we were like mid-mountain just hanging out. We were going to take yeah. a train. All right, no, that was
okay,
Zugspitz,
so you
actually.
Can see the...
And that Zugspitz as well. We actually took a train. I think we went up there twice because I remember taking the tram up there, which was fucking intense, and then taking a really? Train. And you're literally on a train going through a tunnel, like a rocky ass tunnel for like
yeah,
20 minutes.
Really?
Wow.
And there's all these like exit doors.
Like
but
if
the exit
anything
doors
goes
just
wrong,
open up
you're screwed.
They what?
And if anything goes wrong, you're screwed.
Well, you got to go out one of the exit doors.
Yeah.
But the exit doors lead you like to a cliffside.
Oh, God.
It's dumb, so it's like,
yeah.
Got to use your head on that one.
Where's this pick at right here?
So that's in Amsterdam. We went.
Amsterdam's awesome.
Nice. We went
You've
there,
been there
for
right?
it's
I've been there.
It's fun.
Yeah. Yeah.
I couldn't make Amsterdam like the complete I couldn't make that the complete reason for actually going to Europe, but
really.
You know, if you're going to suffer the 8-hour jet lag, like that's not a bad spot to do it because there's always something to do.
Yeah.
I mean, I think the first night I was there, I got my doctor to prescribe me some Ativan for the flight over. And I took the Ativan, took the Benadryl. Basically the same shit we give people at my work when they lose it
yeah.
and they get aggressive.
Yeah.
Like, I got in my mind, I'm like, I hate flying. It's going to be 8 hours. I'm going to chemically restrain myself. It's going to be fucking great. And I took it and I stayed awake the entire 8 hours.
Oh,
like, what the fuck? Like, how did this happen? So I got there and I remember like we were leaving this hotel to go get food. It's just me and my dad, and like I walked out the door and it just hit me all at once. And I'm like, yeah, I gotta go to fucking bed. And I like just turned around, walked to my room, woke up at 2 a.m, got a fucking, went walking, like got a sausage. And yeah, it was cool. There's a lot of cool museums and a lot of history in Amsterdam.
And it's so clean.
Oh, all yeah.
The bikes, like, it's amazing. When you fly in, it's like, holy just crap, comparing they it are to doing somewhere, it right.
Yeah. Like comparing it to somewhere like Portland too. Like Portland, they say it's the weirdest, most promiscuous city in the U.S. And like you go there and like, I like Portland, don't get me wrong, but like it's a fucking dump half the time.
Yeah.
Amsterdam, prostitution's legal. They have a whole section dedicated to prostitution.
And it's clean.
And it's clean. Yeah. All the drugs are legal.
Yeah.
I only saw one homeless person. Like,
yeah.
And there's something to be said about that. I don't know what did it.
And you're required to ride bikes. Like there are thousands in of bikes. Amsterdam. Yeah, it's awesome.
Oh, really? Yeah.
Yeah. It's amazing.
And that picture there is actually the Psych Hospital in Amsterdam.
Whoa. Really? That seems appropriate.
Yeah.
Oh my God, that's
we were
cool.
Like walking and like I took a picture. I'm like, oh, I wonder what that is. And we walked past and it was like the fucking hospital and office of psychiatry.
Really? Wow.
Like
that.
This is their little art outside or something? Like,
yeah, I mean,
what is this?
I don't know.
Wow.
Wow, jeez. Yeah.
So that stuff is more down.
Is this your dog?
That's Toby, yeah.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, he's done a lot
pug
of
pug what?
Pug Tanner? Jack Russell.
Oh, Jack Russell.
So he's done a lot of the
there he is.
A lot of the backpacking trips with me.
How old is he?
He's 5.
Oh yeah. He's like, let's go.
Yeah, he's a super super good boy. That's yeah. That's for sure.
Where the fuck is Duchess? Did we close the bedroom door?
Yeah.
Oh, that's why she's
not
out here.
She'd be right here.
She'd be right in the middle
here. Oh, let's do this one.
Which one? Okay.
Look at that. Look at his harness.
Yeah, it's studded with the survival.
You're trying to make him scary?
How much does he weigh?
He weighs 17.
17 whole pounds. 17 pounds.
No, I saw people wearing those. I went to Portland for a Judas Priest concert, and I saw a bunch of people wearing that. And I'm like...
My dog.
I've always, like... That's mainly the kind of music I like listening to. So I'll, like, do my meal prep every now and then. Especially when Toby was a puppy, I would just blast, like, Ronnie James Dio as I'm cooking food for 4 hours. And, like... Every time I put that kind of music on, he wags his tail. So I'm like, well, you know, it's going to fit. Like,
he rocks hard.
He likes that kind of stuff.
I remember that when you went to Portland for the Judas Priest concert, because you told me about
it. It was fucking dope.
Really? Yeah, Judas Priest. And this was like 2-3 years ago?
A couple years ago, yeah.
Yeah.
Like that was nuts. Cool. Like probably the best. I mean, I went and saw the Stones too, but like... Yeah. It's really Priest. Like a tie up between like the Stones and Judas Priest.
Really?
Because like Judas Priest,
they've been around.
Like, I remember them.
I wasn't a fan of them anymore.
You were a Judas Priest fan. Like I couldn't name a Judas Priest song.
No, but I could sing it. I could make up the words if I heard it.
You could.
But their openers, like I think it was. I don't think it was Testament, but I know it was Saxon. And they're like
Testament.
Saxon, like the guy, the lead guy, was like. I don't even know them that much, but he had fucking gray hair down to here, and they totally killed the show. Like,
wow.
It was just,
really?
It's nothing else like it, that's for sure, man.
Fucking Judas Priest. I actually, you know, was never really a Judas Priest fan, but I remember a lot of my friends back in the day having, like, you know, their Judas Priest t-shirts and shit.
Yeah, I think it's a love. It's a love. You love them or you hate them.
Yeah. What are you trying to do here, dude?
I'm trying to go get back here to fucking YouTube. And this is all can be cut out. That's the magic of editing. Let's go. Let's pull up. Just talk amongst yourselves.
Do.
All right.
You're pulling up Judas Priest?
I am pulling up Judas Priest. What's up?
Yeah, they covered
You've got another thing coming. Do
they
that one.
Covered that. They covered Painkiller.
Is that your favorite you band, would you say? Or?
Not my favorite, but I like them a lot.
What's your fave? Like in that genre.
Oh, it's Dio. 100%.
Oh, okay.
Dio.
I can listen to Dio any day.
You don't remember this?
Yeah, that's a classic.
Yeah. 2,900,000 views.
Hair. I mean, you couldn't even tell, but he didn't have his hair and he couldn't scream like he used to. Like it yeah. just didn't happen.
You gotta add some shit to your Spotify playlist.
Some Judas Priest.
Yeah.
I got Metallica in there.
I know. So this would be more you.
Dio. Oh yeah.
Fucking Dio.
I mean, pretty much any stuff like that. Just super old.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
not like fucking Journey or like the most.
It's not super mainstream. Yeah.
Dio was insane too. Like that guy was fucking short. Like. Performed concerts when he had stomach cancer.
Oh, damn.
Like,
oh, yeah. I loved this music when I was like late teens, early 20s, and I was angry.
Oh, it's still fucking
angry.
Yeah.
I told Chris I was super huge into Metallica because I was such an angry teen. Like, I had to... yeah. And I had the hair and the head banging. And,
she was a rocker. Yeah. I was more like hip-hop because I grew up in, like, the Bay Area.
He's a skater.
Of California. Kid. So, yeah, I was like, skater, hip-hop.
Yeah.
And there was kind of like this whole kind of punk ska thing.
Oh, that's where ska started, isn't it?
Like I think it did, like, formed in California, you know? It's kind of like a more of a English thing with kind of a California twist
we
on it.
We went to
it's
a lot, see a ska band.
We did, yeah, in San Francisco. We saw Monkey. We saw...
It was all brand new to me. I was like...
What was Johnny Rotten, who was...
Oh, no shit.
Yeah, yeah, he was at this club in San Francisco. Yeah, we saw Johnny Rotten.
That's
yeah, and this was just like a few years ago. And to me, it was cool, you know, but she was like, are they going to do any covers?
Yeah, I totally didn't understand the whole concept.
Yeah. So it was a
and the dancing
cool
thing.
Yeah, I mean, it's a total style of dancing, skanking.
Oh yeah, no, you know, I had a couple buddies who were really into that growing up. Yeah. I don't mind ska music. It's just not like, I don't know. It's not my favorite. It's not my first pick. Most days.
Yeah, I grew up in California, so it was a like back when I was a like teenager and early 20s. It was a big, you know, like cool genre of music between. I mean, I guess alternative people, you know, not like the mainstream pop top 40 shit.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
Yeah. Like everyone, a lot of people know about it now.
Yeah. Now. All right. What are we on to next? Have you ever been on a backpacking trip where you didn't have enough food?
No, I don't think so.
No.
I mean, like, maybe, like, enough food that I like.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, like, I'll eat oatmeal, but, like, I don't necessarily want to fucking make oatmeal right when
are
I wake up.
Are you a cold soaker, or are you, like, get out your grill?
I have a little, like, jet boil, or a little, like, heat.
Oh, okay, yeah.
So, like, I'll make coffee. Like, I'll make the oatmeal. Mm-hmm. I mean, if I need to, I was thinking of it last time because like, I love, like, I eat a shit ton of bananas, like, good carb content, like, good, super good for you. I need to start dehydrating the food that I want to bring, and I think I'll eat more then. But right now, and if you get the right MREs too, I mean, you get the ones like you can get like there's one I think I forget who makes it, but it's like an apple strudel. It's like fucking 300 grams of carbs.
Oh dang!
And it's literally just that big. It's so fucking good.
Wow!
It is so fucking
good.
Well,
yeah.
Yeah. Really.
Like if you eat one of those, like you're good for a few hours.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
You'll be okay.
Have you done the ice cream sandwich?
I have.
You have. What do you think of that? I think
we did.
No, I haven't done the ice cream sandwich.
Okay.
I thought about it.
This is not great.
Mountain House or something.
Didn't we think it wasn't great?
It wasn't that good.
No. Maybe if we put it in the freezer first, but
and maybe if we were backpacking,
but you wouldn't have a freezer.
Yeah,
the way that I kind of see it is like if I work hard enough and work up an appetite, I'll eat whatever.
Yeah,
like that's true. Yeah,
that's kind of how I do it here. Like I with the meal prepping that I do, like I'll eat bland sweet potatoes and ground turkey. I don't like it, but
yeah,
if it's been 4 hours since my last meal, like I will like it.
Sustenance.
Yeah, right.
Like, I will eat it. It'll be good. I'll enjoy it.
Gut feel.
Yeah.
Feel. That's true. And energy. Yeah. Sheesh. So in Switzerland, when you were there, so you said you didn't ski. How long were you in Switzerland?
We were there about a week. We did a lot of hiking. Or I did hiking. My dad, there's something wrong with his knee. He didn't hike.
Was it just the two of you?
Yeah.
Oh, nice. That's awesome.
Yeah, it was great.
Yeah.
We went out to eat a lot. We went to like spots where he had been when he lived there.
Oh, that's cool. So he got to show you and
Yeah.
Oh, cool. Like he showed me some villages, showed me some spots to like go skiing, which actually like to rent skis, to rent the equipment over there is pretty much the exact same price as it is here.
Really?
But flying over there in the winter is like it's a lot of money.
Did you check in on lift ticket prices? Are they outrageous?
I think they're probably comparable.
Oh really?
I didn't look, but I know Vail Resorts own some of the ski areas out there.
Oh okay.
Oh yeah.
Which they're not the greatest, but at the same time not the greatest company, but at the same time like you have somewhat consistency. Mm-hmm. Or you know what you're expecting with that.
Yeah.
No, we went to a couple areas too where you basically like there's towns where the only way you can get to them is by taking a chairlift.
Really? Yeah.
Oh, so
that's kind of cool.
That's super cool. Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's just like you're literally just in a gondola and like there's people like carrying their groceries up and whatnot. Like,
oh, that's amazing.
Wow. Yeah.
That's their life.
Yeah, just rolling green hills with
and like cows let's go and grocery shopping, get on the gondola.
Pretty much, yeah.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Wow. That's way different than hopping in the car and going to Winco.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That
yeah,
seems way cooler.
Yeah.
People generally, I think they survive off of less there.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that's a thing,
The stuff that they have, they use like every bit of.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, like if you have cows or like you have cattle there, like it's not like
there's no waste.
Here you have, they go to the butcher yard, their hides get scrapped, their bones get scrapped. They're like, I went into a butcher shop and got a pelt, like a sheep pelt,
mm-hmm.
for like $100, and just came off a sheep. I think they cooked the meat and they used the bones for something else, but they don't waste.
Yeah.
And they garden a fuck ton out there.
It's beautiful.
Just the water. Mm-hmm. It's like all, it's either gray or it's like turquoise. It's just nuts. Wow. Everywhere you go out there is pretty much by train.
I love that mode of transportation.
I do too when the tracks are good. The tracks in Holland fucking suck.
Oh, really?
I like thought I was going to puke coming out of Holland because it's literally just like that for 2 hours.
Really?
Oh, wow. Then you get into Germany and it's just smooth sailing.
Really?
Like everything's brand new and it's just super nice. But
they may have been high in Holland.
Yeah, maybe Holland there just because they've had legal weed for a long time.
It's
like
this is good enough.
These tracks are fine.
They're probably just like fuck it.
Yeah,
right. They're all high.
Damn. Yeah, I don't. Holland's different though. Like I like. I don't know. I think like everywhere we went, like I was super like. There's good and there's bad, but at the same time, like it was just. it's a lifestyle that I could get down on.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Could you see yourself moving there?
Potentially.
Yeah.
I don't think they wouldn't take me though. Holland, though,
you're too American.
You can get into Ireland and you can into Holland a lot easier though.
Oh, okay.
But Germany, it's like their social system out there, their government system, it's like, I don't know what their taxes are, what they pay in taxes to live there, but mm-hmm. I know that the kids, like little kids, get, you know, funded preschool, which is super important.
Oh, wow.
The schools are really good. The healthcare is decent. And, like, pretty much everyone has a job.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know what they pay in taxes to afford those luxuries.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I just don't, like... I don't know. I'd have to know. I mean, I'd live out there. Like if it was like worth it,
mm-hmm.
I would totally do it, but I just don't know if it'd be worth it.
Yeah.
Cause I mean, where I went was, we were in like kind of a resorty area,
mm-hmm.
or like a touristy area. I don't think I'd want to live in somewhere like Berlin, or like I could probably live in Munich, but I think the quality of life would be better in the countryside. Mm-hmm. And I don't think at this point in my life, I'm not going to go over there with the skills to, the vocational skills to achieve that, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's, I don't know, man. Like I was like, there's people out there who are my age or younger who are like already fucking like doctors and shit. Like,
dang,
their education program is so good. Like it makes ours look like such shit.
Yeah, I know.
I mean,
well, you were recently telling me about, you've been to CWI for so many years. And you were like, I don't feel any smarter at all.
Well, I mean, like, yeah. I've been going part-time.
Yeah.
And, like, I've changed majors a couple of times.
But still, you should feel smarter.
Yeah.
The only classes I really benefited from there was probably victimology and nutrition.
Really?
So I can understand work and, like, why people are the way they are based off of something that happened to them.
Mm-hmm.
Because of victimology, and I can actually, like, I don't get into like too much of the political debates these days because of that, because it's like, look, like this is how this goes, this is how a trauma mm-hmm. response goes, this is how this act is going to affect someone.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, half the classes there, it's just like I either already knew it or I zone out, because they're just super political about things, and that's not what I signed up for. I knew it's what I signed up for, but it's not what I wanted to sign up for. So,
yeah.
But I don't think I'm any better off. I mean, I think I just spent a fuck ton of money, and I'm going to spend a fuck ton more.
That's weird.
And read my own books and do my own knowledge, get my own knowledge.
Yeah. I think that's way more valuable than like going to a university or a community college.
Yeah,
experience. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I don't plan. So I'm going for like mental health therapists, but I don't plan to. I mean, I plan, like, obviously I'm going to learn some decent shit when I go to ISU.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But at the same time, like, I don't want to base everything in the therapy off of what I learned in school. Because, I mean, I'm not going to name names, but, like, we've worked with a couple of people who do that. It's not mm-hmm. really effective.
Yeah.
You have to go a little off the rails as a therapist.
Yeah.
You've got to be kind of fucked up yourself.
Yeah.
Do a lot of.
It can't just.
I mean, some book learning for psych, but, you know, but more it's like a feel, really.
If you're working with somebody who's super borderline.
Yeah.
Like, do you call them on their shit or do you continue letting them do their shit and get worse?
Mm hmm.
Just because your professor says that's what you should do because it's polite.
Yeah.
Like, I'm like, no, I'll call you on your shit. Like, you're not going to get fucking better. But
yeah,
that's kind of how I feel with school. I mean,
so you're going to go to ISU in the counseling program?
Social work.
Social work.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Speaking of that real quick, and I have this in my notes, and we've talked about it previously, about pressing charges on psychotic patients.
This is a conversation Chris and
I have. We've had this, yeah.
And
well, my thing on it,
it's a tough one.
My thing on it is if they're psychotic, I think it's unique to the situation. Like if they're,
yeah.
I mean, if hypothetically, if we have a patient who they're psychotic and they hit one of us or they throw a chair at one of us. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm not going to press charges if they do that. Unless the only way that I'll get workman's comp is by doing that, which I don't agree with. But if we have a patient who is coming off of meth, high on heroin, coming off of heroin, and or they're just being a fucking dick and mm-hmm. they want to behave like that, I have no issues with it.
Yeah. Yeah, if you're being a dick, if it's so super
behavioral patient, yeah. You're fine.
I totally
But I think
if you're just out of your mind, had a break.
Yeah,
that's where I don't get it.
Because we just recently, like last week, had a situation where an employee got hit.
Yeah, I heard about that.
Yeah, and I don't know what happened to it. I don't know if he decided to press charges or not. But the patient was clearly psychotic mm-hmm. when I went to the code.
That's so
like
weird.
I could see that he was psychotic. And to me, it's kind of like, what the fuck do I do? It's a gray area, you know?
I mean, I think with... Because the excuse that I hear a lot at work is, oh, he's too aggressive and we just can't handle that kind of behavior here. But I've heard that at Cottonwood Creek. I've heard that at Intermountain. I haven't heard that at West Valley when I worked the psych unit there because they had mechanical restraints and they used fucking those and they used antipsychotics. They had zero tolerance for that type of shit.
Yeah.
But I think it falls back on not us as the psych techs and nurses, but like us as the hospital, where it's like, look, if we want to admit these people who are violent and aggressive, and right, like it's going to happen every now and then, like it's inpatient psych, like you're going to, restraints are going to happen, like you're going to get hit. It's just, it's how part it fucking of the gig. Goes. Yeah.
Yeah.
But if we're going to admit people who are straight out of fucking prison, or who are straight out of a situation that leads them to feel more inclined to do something violent towards you, or if we're going to admit only these people and we're not going to screen for this kind of stuff, then I think we need to do more as a hospital. And when I say that, I mean, if we're going to have these kinds of people, like we need to, like, half the nurses won't initiate a restraint because of the paperwork. They could be destroying the unit. They could be making the other patients completely anxious and uncomfortable and wanting them to fight, but it's too much paperwork. We need to eliminate the amount of paperwork. I mean, if we can do that, but we also need to have nurses and have people on who know that this is how it goes sometimes, rather than letting somebody just run rampant like that for two or three days and then pop off and then say, oh, we've dealt with him for so many days doing this. It's like, you haven't dealt with him because I think there's an intervention for every behavior. And if you're running around slamming doors, if you're threatening your peers, posturing people, the intervention is medication. And if you touch someone, the intervention is being held down.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's been plenty of psychotic patients, you know, like I worked with a couple at Cottonwood where it's like, it shouldn't have fucking went down like that. Like they should not have fucking gone to jail. Like, if we use the excuse that, CPI just didn't do it, well, maybe we should do something different than CPI. Because if you have a patient who's psychotic and they're hitting people, A, your verbal de-escalation didn't work. And even with verbal de-escalation, like if someone's out of their fucking mind, like it doesn't, you could fucking tell them you're giving them $1 million and it's going to be the same response. Yeah. Like if somebody is that psychotic and that sick, like,
yeah,
I mean, I'll say it, and like a lot of people think it's barbaric and a lot of people think it's fucked up, but if you're unable to decide for yourself, you should be given fucking meds.
Yeah.
If you're that psychotic, like, doesn't matter if you're aggressive, like you should be fucking given the shot, and then when you're coherent,
right,
make your decisions, because we're not doing anything for them other than letting them get worse, and we're not really, I mean, they're paying the fucking bill,
right?
If I had a psychotic break for a week and nobody gave me meds.
Right.
Because like, they didn't want to do the paperwork because they didn't want to fucking, they didn't want three people to fucking hold me down while they gave me a shot in my fucking arm or my ass. Like, and I got up and I came out of it and I'm like, why the fuck didn't you guys do this? Like, it's not fair.
Yeah.
You know, like,
do you feel a person who has a mental illness should be under the same set of laws as someone who doesn't?
I think it just depends on the mental illness. I mean, I have type 2 bipolar. Like, I follow the same rules as everyone else. I have depression.
Yeah.
I think that if somebody has a cognitive impairment, like a lower IQ below, like, I don't know, 7, I forget what the numbers are for, like, retardation, but if somebody's retarded, no, they shouldn't be.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
But, or if somebody's psychotic, like, there should be some sort of, like, different type of treatment. I mean, it's really tricky to say, because we had that psychotic guy fucking go in and stab a bunch of little girls in Boise. Like, that guy was psychotic as fuck.
Yeah. Like, what is his punishment, you know?
Because we don't, like, we're doing away with state hospitals. We're doing away with long-term treatment because we can just throw these people in group homes now.
Yeah.
So, maybe bring back long-term psychiatric treatment. Like, life, like, lifelong.
Mm-hmm. Like, and that's where they live.
State Hospital South, you're going to, you're like there Switzy. For life. Well, Switzy's more developmental. I mean, because, like, that guy who killed all those kids, that guy could probably, like, if they stabilized that guy, he wouldn't be appropriate for Switzy.
Oh, okay.
But he would still be appropriate for somewhere where he would be going to these classes, where he would be going to these groups, where he'd be medication would be monitored.
Yeah.
I think that's, like, that's somewhere where we're failing as a society is...
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
Is that, I mean, it's great we have all these antipsychotics, but, like, because that was a big push with, like, deinstitutionalization. So, oh, we have Thorazine now, we have Abilify, we have all this, but, like, how do you expect a psychotic person to go spend $600-$700 on a fucking long acting?
Well,
how is that going to work?
And that's, like, the thing at Intermountain, logic is that? Like, when patients discharge, they're put on this, like, extremely expensive medication that Medicare is not going to cover, and they're on Medicare.
Wow. Dude, I was on an antidepressant that was $300 a month.
Oh my god. Wow.
And, like, it's not anymore. It's still expensive, but, like, yeah, I was put on that, and it's just like, fuck, like, it just, the pieces don't fucking add up. Like, I think mental health's more, like, I think a lot of people want to talk about mental health and psychiatric issues, but they want to talk about that on a level of ego and on a level of altruism versus a level of, like, reality and, like, this is how it really is. Like, how is it when you're suicidal? How is it when you go to the ER because you're suicidal or because you have a mental disorder? Like, bam, paper scrubs, bam, you have a sitter, bam, we're not going to listen to anything you say because you're psychotic, bam, you're going to Intermountain, you don't have a choice, like, but you're still mentally ill and it's still a disease and you still deserve compassion, but it's not really compassionate. Like, I don't think,
right.
I mean, I'll say it, like, I think we have a lot of good people working at Intermountain, but our facility's fucking filthy.
What would you say that about any mental health?
Cottonwood and West Valley were fucking clean.
Really?
Yep.
Why'd you stop working at Cottonwood then?
So when I went to Europe for a month, the director of nursing there had said it was okay and that I could use my PTO. When I got over there, my PTO wasn't transferred. And before I went, they changed their mind and said, oh, you actually have to come back PRN and we can probably try to get you full time. So I'm over there. My PTO didn't go through. I call them, text them, email them weekly while I'm over there.
Yeah.
About the third week, I'm just like, fuck this. Like, they've dicked me around on my schedule. There's clearly some nepotism going on between the DON and certain techs and certain nurses. I'll take the dollar pay cut and I'll go back to Intermountain.
Yeah.
And when I got back into town, it took me calling 2-3 more times, then calling the CEO asking for my PTO, which it was like, it's like $700-$800.
Yeah.
It's like, I was planning on coming home and, like, not having fucking rent. Like, right. It was like a big deal. Yeah. And
yeah,
you know, like, that just, it is what it is with that. I'm not, like, necessarily butthurt about leaving there.
Yeah. The thing about Intermountain is, the main thing is, I've never been denied time off.
Yeah.
From then.
Dude, that's
from them, yeah.
Legit. I mean, like, that's one of the best things about it there is, I mean, if I need time off, I can get it off. Like,
yeah, and I've got a good schedule.
I spent so much money fucking on my truck, like, putting shit together in there, like, to where the point where I'm, like, almost broke. doesn't fucking matter, because I can just, I could pick up fucking 24, I could pick up 20 hours in a day and work it if I wanted.
Yeah, you could. Yeah, yeah.
I mean, I can be fucking 5-6 minutes late. They don't give a shit.
Like, yeah, that's a perfect
they're
job.
They're not gonna say yeah, shit. Exactly. Yeah, exactly. I mean, you can really be 20 minutes late most of the time, and no one's gonna say shit because report's still going on. And you're like, oh, okay, I showed up. I'm good. Like, let's do handoff and start the day.
Yeah,
that's a good thing. Like, I don't really worry about being late there.
I try to do it just because I want to be in the habit of like being on time, but like, dude, I'm
well,
like,
yeah,
I'm
yeah.
like 5-10 minutes like every like I just I'm at the like, and there's some days where it's like I'm making my sandwich at home 7:02.
Like, yeah,
oh well, like fuck it, like
I'm there usually early, I'm just like, okay, we got report. We got 30 minutes late.
Remember that one time?
One of two male texts on my end of the week.
Tell this story and I'm going to go to the bathroom.
Oh, no. I don't want to.
Are you serious? Know this story. I had to pee really
bad. Well, it was one time when Chris was late for work and he hops up and goes, I'm late. You were like 20 minutes late?
Something like that.
And I go, I jumped out and I said, oh my God, what do I do? Like, totally freaking out. And he's like, you can go back to sleep. I'm just going to get ready and go to work. Because I was thinking like it was another job where you're like, this is terrible. And he's like, no, we're good. So.
No, yeah. they're pretty, I mean, I don't know. Like, I mean, I'll say, like, just with Intermountain compared to like, I mean, West Valley was stricter. They had a lot more structure.
Yeah.
And they were a lot more like hands on, but yeah, Cottonwood is. When I worked at Cottonwood and worked at Intermountain, there is no structure.
Oh, wow.
There's very little structure, and it's like a lot of jobs where like there's a huge social aspect to it, mm-hmm. which I mean, you're gonna find that anywhere, I think, but mm-hmm. at the same time, it's like when I worked at West Valley, like, and nothing against people who are LDS, but mm-hmm. everyone was fucking LDS.
Oh, really?
And like, that's just what somebody told me, is that everybody was LDS. Mm-hmm. And I was like, okay, that makes sense why everyone's so fucking standoffish. Like, yeah. I'm over here cussing like a sailor.
And they are not.
I'm like, I'm 28, 29, like, working as a psych tech. These people are like 25, like already out of school. And I'm just like, all right, cool. Like, whatever, bro.
Yeah.
So, I mean, there's that, but good thing about Intermountain is, yeah, you can be late. Like, you can work as much as you want, take as much time off as you want.
Yeah, they seem like flexible. They'll work.
I think
with
they
you.
Understand that it's like not the greatest environment sometimes.
It's rough. I don't think I could do it. I think it takes a certain personality type or something. Because, yeah.
Oh yeah, I'm more. I'd work with psych over rehab most days. I mean, I work the rehab side a lot, so it's like not a huge issue, but I don't mind. I have a lot more patience for psych versus somebody who's just an alcoholic who is wanting to be a fucking dick.
Yeah, exactly.
A hard time, like,
the behavioral side, I think, would be hard for me. Like, oh, you're just being a jerk.
Keeping my mouth shut on that sometimes. It's kind of rough.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I'm excited to be doing more than teching, but it's a couple years off for sure.
Wait, what's your... are you doing more than teching?
Social working.
Oh, okay. Is that what you're in school for?
Yeah, so like therapy and stuff like that.
Oh, sweet. Nice. All right, and we're back. All right, so, God, what else do we have to say about work? What's your favorite unit to work in?
No, I don't know, man. Like, I used to like working East a lot when there is structure, but like when there's no structure on East, it fucking sucks.
Yeah,
it's fucking
East
horrible.
Is fucking changed.
It's yeah. Like I still do shit the same way over there, and a lot of kids don't like it. But
yeah,
it's tough shit, I guess. I mean, it's not
fucking
it's not
East.
Slumber party, like, you know, just get to smoke meth and fucking come hang out with your buddies, like.
Yeah, because I've worked on East for close to 7 years.
Yeah. Oh yeah, dude.
And it's changed a lot. Before, we got like depressed, suicidal, psychotic kids. Now we're still getting that, but we're getting more juvie kids in there.
And I'm like,
and that sucks.
I'm fine with my biggest thing with that, like, I mean, I'm probably going to apply at the juvie center in Pocatello when I move there, but it's, I'm fine with working with juvie kids, but like, we just need a we need the approach that matches that. Like,
yeah, and I don't think Intermountain has that.
These kids are like, there's some little, there's not a lot of techs there, and not a lot of nurses that understand how to actually run a unit based off of like trauma informed care.
Yeah.
And you still set limits and you still set boundaries and you still put your foot down with trauma informed care. But I think what I see happening now is, you know, we have people who try to do the trauma informed care, but you have these kids who will manipulate their fucking way out of it.
Yeah.
And we have a kid, I mean, we got a kid there, safe to say we have a kid there doing that now.
Yeah. And oh yeah.
Anytime. It's not nothing. I mean, it's one of those things where it's just, it all boils down to like leadership. But when I say leadership, I don't just mean, oh, the director of nursing needs to do this.
No,
oh, the lead techs need to do that. Oh, the CEO. It's like, no, like,
it comes down through the ranks.
It's everybody. Like,
yeah,
if you apply for a job there, like, you need to have work ethic and you need to like uphold the way things are.
Yeah.
Like, there needs to be a system, like, more people need to be showing leadership.
Yeah.
Whether they're a tech, whether they're lead tech, whether they're a nurse, whether they're charge nurse, like, you name it. Like, there's just, the leadership is just lacking. And that's,
yeah,
leadership and the viewpoints on how things should be are lacking. That's why it is the way it is, I think.
Yeah. And for me, and I think I've said this to you before, I would rather any day deal with a psychotic teenager than a behavioral teenager.
Yeah, we were talking about
that. Oh, yeah, totally.
Yeah. Yeah. I was like, I feel like
if the they're just being dicks.
I was fucking in juvie a bunch growing up. Like, yeah. So I'm under the way that I roll is like, if you're just going to be a fucking
dick. Were they drug charges or like violent charges?
Like assaults, like probation violations, dirty UAs.
Yeah.
But I was in there and it's like, that's how it handled. I remember like, I never like got attitude with any of the guards. They're actually all really like, they're really fucking chill with you. Like until you.
Yeah.
Start being a dick, and then they're like 50 times more a fucking dick. So, but I remember one kid was like freaking out over something, and literally, like, it was, he wasn't psychotic, he was just fucking pissed and like hitting shit. And the guard's just sitting there laughing at him, like, what are you fucking gonna do? Like,
yeah,
how is this gonna benefit your sit? That's kind of my approach, though, to a lot of
like behaviors. I wish we could do that.
I mean, I'm not gonna sit there and laugh at him, but I'm just like,
yeah,
we had a kid the other day, he's like throwing some. It's like, all right, dude, you fucking feel better? Like,
yeah.
Maybe if you throw the whole fucking rack, you will. And then you're gonna look like a dumbass picking it up.
In there, yeah. You know?
So I don't know. That's kind of like the clientele that I want to go and working with. So I'm like, I'm fine with it, but I just, we're fucking pussies about it. And I think it was when we had our old director of nursing and our old program manager. They wanted to be very laissez-faire with everything.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, that's that. I mean, I think that's just what did it. That's my opinion, though. I mean, we had a program manager, we have kids over there throwing desks, assaulting other people, and the program manager comes over and blames the staff. Like, that, yeah. Like that type of shit. Like, fuck no.
Did that program manager's name start with a C?
No.
Oh.
Letter after C, though.
Oh. So,
I mean, I like her as a person, but at the same time, like, we don't see eye to eye on that level. You know, like, and that's just, I saw more eye to eye with fucking Carla. On certain things.
Oh, see.
Not on everything, but on certain things, yeah, like putting your foot down, like following the rules, like that shit. But
she,
like,
definitely put her foot down.
Yeah, she was good at that.
Yeah, but I had times where she came on to East and she was like almost as erratic as any fucking adolescent patient that we had.
Oh, I remember
like throwing charts around and shit. Yeah.
So dude, I believe it.
We won't mention names, but
yeah. I don't know. I think that place can bring out the best in some people and it can bring out the worst in some people.
Yeah. It's
you got to know when to put your fucking, fold your hand, you know?
Yeah. And so fucking new start, because you've had, You have a degree in alcohol and substance abuse.
I have a bachelor of science with a minor in alcohol and drugs.
Yeah, and so new start. Let's talk about that and entitlement.
Dude.
And shit.
I'm so like, I'm just on autopilot when I'm over there.
Really?
Yeah.
Like, so you are a recovering addict. You stopped shit when you were 17, 18 years old. How do you feel going to new start?
I don't know. Like, I mean, like, it's easy to tell, like, if somebody wants to get clean and, like, wants to get sober.
Yeah.
But, like, the thing about getting clean and sober, and I think a lot of rehab places do this, they make it seem like it's going to be some fucking great and fun experience, and it really just, it sucks dick. Like, it's fucking horrible. It's not a good time.
Yeah.
So I don't.
That's what the pamphlet should say. This sucks dick. Yeah. You got this.
But it'll get better.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I see that, and it's just, I can't say anything. I mean, it's my job. I got to pay the fucking rent. I got to build my savings account and do what I need to do. But, like, I don't know. I know that if I were to call somebody on their shit over there, I would get written up.
Oh, dang.
Like, I know, because it's very much, it's just business there. Like, that's what it is. I mean, like, true. You have Dr. T, and, like, Dr. T's really fucking smart, really passionate about what he does.
Yeah.
He's a great, it's a tremendous asset to that unit. And so are a lot of the nurses that work over there. But I think that when I see my charge nurse who has 30 assessments to do.
Yeah.
Charge nurse who's like competent, good at her job, not like half-ass as shit. But when she has 30 assessments to do, like, I don't necessarily get the impression that all the patients are, you know, getting the care that they should be getting.
Yeah.
And I think that we should give them more freedom. They should be able to smoke whenever they want to smoke. You know?
That's true. Can they do that at St. Al's?
They can do that at North Point.
Oh, at North Point. That's up on Mountain View?
On Eustick. So they can do that at North Point. I think they can do it at the Walker Center.
But Cottonwood-like.
They can't smoke there.
Okay, same as Intermountain. You have smoke breaks or not? No smoking at all.
No smoking at all.
Wow. That's rough when you're coming off something really hard. Well,
Intermountain's like that too. The only places you can smoke is New Start, the drug and alcohol rehab. None of the other units.
Yeah, that's rough.
I mean, I think that there could be a lot of restructuring, but I don't think it's ever going to happen there because it's, unless they change like corporate ownership, I don't think it'll happen because there's just too much about money there. I mean, what, 30 days on New Start's what, like 30 fucking grand?
Holy crap.
So when we got 30 patients, we want to keep that census.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know?
Wow.
Like,
and it's gone. It's way different now that they accept Medicaid.
That fucking, like, I'm sorry, but like, that's not, that hurts. They need to rewrite and adjust the program now that we have Medicaid.
Yeah.
Medicaid, I mean, it's not that people that get Medicaid are fucking bad and undeserving. It's more the fact that, like, Medicaid, well, you'll have somebody coming in and they'll be there for rehab. They'll get a week and a half of rehab, and then Medicaid will randomly decide, oh, well, we're not going to pay for you anymore.
Yeah.
And they're just, well, what the fuck is this? And they go out and they relapse, or they're the best patient on the unit. They're showing the most leadership. They leave, the unit goes to shit. Like, I don't.
Well, that's the thing with insurance. It doesn't account for like,
oh no,
personal fucking behaviors or actions.
Oh, absolutely not.
Yeah, you're a number.
Yeah, you're a number within.
No, I mean, you're treated better if you're a heroin addict than if you're schizophrenic. Like, that's just how it is.
Really.
Not that like heroin addicts should be treated like shit, but like,
but yeah, in
like the they're system, both pretty fucking debilitating disorders. Like,
yeah,
I mean, yeah. you should be able to.
But it's different. One's need. A choice.
Well, like it was.
It was a choice.
Yeah,
at the beginning. Yeah, yeah.
That's. I mean, I kind of believe. I mean, like, I believe it like to an extent. I mean, I'm not saying
I feel like this
fucking balls deep in addiction that you can just say, oh, I don't want to do it anymore. But like, you have your checkpoints.
Yeah.
Like you have your checkpoint of, oh,
do it. Yeah. Do I want to fuck over my family or do heroin?
I'm going to be late for my son's birthday party. Oh, it's okay. He won't care. He's only four. He doesn't understand. Oh, well, I'm going to miss dinner with my wife. Oh, screw it. I got to do this. But each time you do that, it's like you have that moment where it's like you kind of feel like a piece of shit. But you just go with it. Yeah. And eventually that becomes the norm, and it just gets deeper and deeper and deeper.
Yeah, it's true.
I think that's
the... like psychosis, and as far as dealing with patients, and the legal terms are the same as drug-induced psychosis.
What do you mean legal terms?
So say if someone who has a drug-induced psychosis assaults somebody... Do you feel that they are accountable the same way as someone who's just psychotic?
So what? It really just depends on how psychotic. Because I mean, if you take a hit at LSD right now, you'll trip balls for a little bit.
Yeah.
Are you high or are you psychotic?
I don't know. Say I go out and kill somebody.
When you're high.
Yeah.
Then I would say that's more of a criminal thing.
Okay.
Versus. If you took the LSD, one hit of LSD that should have only lasted, your high should have only lasted you a day, but we're 15 days later.
And you're still fucking
And you're
high.
Still fucked up.
Then like you have psychosis. Switched.
Then that's, yeah, then you're
because
stuck.
Because that can happen.
Get out.
Yeah. It can happen one time.
Okay.
With some people.
Because I could believe that if you took a hit of acid right now, you took that because you had a desired effect that you wanted to achieve.
Yeah.
I don't think that you want to be fucking on that same trip 15 days
from now.
I don't think that was the fucking
goal. You're exhausted, like, dude.
I don't think you were aiming for the 15 days of no sleep. Like, I don't think that was in the fucking book.
Yeah. Okay.
So that's kind of where I draw the line with that. I mean, if you're high and you do something, I mean, if I get drunk right now and... go drive and, you know, kill someone, it's manslaughter. I mean, it's manslaughter if I'm psychotic too, but the difference is if I'm drunk and I come out of that and I wake up sober, I'm gonna go through the punishment sober. Whereas if I'm psychotic from the detox, I'll more than likely go through the punishment sober, but it's gonna be taken into account, and I'm gonna have the opportunity, or I would hope I would have the opportunity to kind of make everything right that I could. Because I wouldn't plan on doing something like that. Because the whole goal of quitting drinking is to be a better person. So if you quit drinking and you kill someone when you're psychotic because of your withdrawals, like, obviously that's not the intent.
Yeah.
It's kind of that's how I would argue it anyways.
Okay. Yeah, because for me, it's always been like a gray area. And I've never been assaulted at work to a point where I felt I needed to press charges, but I've always thought, like, what would I do? Like, would I charges just because I've been hurt, or do I, you know this patient is psychotic and don't press charges because of that, or if the patient's just behavioral?
I think too, like, we see one side of it. Like, I've pressed charges on a kid on East. He was super behavioral. He hit me in the face like 10 times. Wasn't psychotic.
Yeah.
Yeah, I totally see that.
But what ended up happening with that is the prosecutor called me and said, we're lowering this now to a misdemeanor. So they do have to go through the judicial system. They do get the notes from the jail on how they're doing, especially if they're in the medical ward, which they would be. And if they go to court, the judge is going to see, like, how fucked they are.
Yeah. And
it's also, too, like, if you're on a commitment and you go into jail, you can go to Blackfoot faster. Like, I remember when I got sent to rehab when I was 17, they brought me from the juvie center in Boise to Idaho Falls, but we had to make a stop at the jail because we were picking up a lady who was getting committed to Blackfoot. So a lot of the times... I think it could work out better for some of the patients. But it really, I don't know. I mean, I guess what I'm getting at is I don't feel like every psychotic patient who has been charged with that felony is on felony probation or they're a felon. I think it probably gets dropped.
A healthcare worker felony.
It's like fucking Dana, her fucking son. or I think it was her son, but he big fucking like body, like built fucking guy. He hit four of us in the face. He didn't hit me in the face, but he just, he was super psychotic. Like, he got arrested. I don't think he's gonna fucking go to prison. Mm-hmm. I don't think he's gonna be fucked for the rest of his life.
Yeah.
You know, but he will pay a fine. He'll pay the court fees. He might get some community service. Yeah.
Yeah.
But I don't think he's gonna.
It's not gonna ruin his life.
It's not gonna ruin his life. Some people, though, if you have a history of doing it, yeah, mm-hmm. I think it would.
But, so let's say, and let's take it to an extreme, a psychotic patient that, or a psychotic person, not really a patient we've dealt with, that kills a person. Now, and the things that I've researched over like the past few years, there's only been two cases of where insanity, or not guilty by insanity, have actually taken place.
Well, Idaho doesn't have that.
No, they don't.
Yeah, Idaho, only, we, yeah. When I interviewed for a job at the prison, they actually showed me where they do that, the insanity restoration, like where they restore mm-hmm. people to sanity. It's either at the state hospital in Blackfoot, mm-hmm. but if they're too violent, then they go to health and welfare has, I think, four or five fucking cells at maximum security where they can send people.
Yeah, and I've heard of those.
Basically, like, I think in that case, like, it's all about, like, the victim of that. Mm-hmm. Like, if your brother got the shit beat out of him by somebody who is psychotic, right?
Yeah.
And he went to Blackfoot, or he went to Mac, south of town. They gave him meds. They basically stabilized him. Mm-hmm. He comes out. You're sitting across from a court, and he is in tears because he can't believe he did something like that.
Yeah.
Like, you can visibly see that this guy is sorry. Your brother's still in the fucking hospital recovering.
Yeah.
But this guy is seriously, like, he didn't know what happened.
Yeah.
Like, you got to put yourself in that person's shoes.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know how adult court works that much compared to juvenile court, but I know in juvenile court, the judge can force you into fucking counseling. They can force you into med compliance. They can force you to pretty much, like, be fucking stable against your will.
Mm. Yeah, in juvenile court.
In juvenile court. Like, they can fucking basically Dr. Armstrong you from a fucking different location.
Okay.
They can fucking say, hey, if you're not going to take these meds on the outside, if you're not going to go to counseling on the outside, you can come to the detention center and we will force medicate you.
Oh, dang.
And we will fucking, if you act up, we will restrain you to a fucking bed and we will force you to go to counseling. So you either do it out here or you do it out there.
Wow.
In terms of probation.
But either way, it's happening.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, that's kind of, I mean, I can support that. I mean, if I was in that situation, that's basically like saying, look, you were basically saying to the offender, like, look, you really fucked up. We know you didn't mean to, but somebody's in the hospital. There needs to be accountability. So here are your options. Mm-hmm. If you're really sorry, you can pay the restitution. You can pay the fines. You can make everything. You can do everything in your power to make that better. But you have to take your meds. You have to go to counseling. You have to do this. And if you don't want to do that, you can get your sentence of X amount of years.
Yeah.
Like, I'm more in favor of something like that versus, oh, somebody with schizophrenia or somebody who is psychotic beat the shit out of somebody. Like, let's just send them to a hospital where they'll get a decent meal every day. They'll get a comfy bed. They'll get medication. They won't have to buy their groceries. They won't have any sort of responsibility.
Yeah.
Like, I'm more for, like, you fucked up, here's what you're going to do.
Yeah.
Versus that.
How do you feel about homeless patients coming in and just taking a bed? And we'll end with this.
I think, I don't know. I mean, there's always the bed. I don't get the impression at Intermountain that they're taking up a bed that somebody else can use. We have so many fucking beds at Intermountain.
It is true.
Cottonwood has so many fucking beds. I don't know how many beds St. Al's has. I know there's Safe Haven too, and I know there's West Valley. And I know that the floors at some of the hospitals will take these patients. I think that we should have a different approach. I mean, if somebody, like, I've seen it on ICU plenty of times, like, somebody says, oh, I'm suicidal, they get a one-to-one and they're having the time of their fucking life, you know, drinking cranberry juice, playing cards with the other patients.
Yeah.
And it's just like, everybody sees it, the doctor sees it. They literally, I'm serious. It
drinking cranberry juice and playing cards.
They used to get cran grape, but they don't get that.
No, they don't get it anymore.
No, they fucking eliminate cran grape.
Because that was too good.
It was too good. People were getting, patients were gaining weight. Now they just get straight cranberry. Yeah. That's real.
You only get two.
Yeah. And there is a lot of kid at snack times now.
I think that if someone is homeless and that's their lifestyle, is we're gonna say that they're suicidal, they're gonna come in and do nothing, I think that's the name of the fucking game with psych. But I also think too that if you're homeless and you're suicidal, or that you're just looking for a bed, there should be a different approach in care planning for that.
Yeah,
meaning,
yeah,
like,
that's true.
Rather than, oh, so and so is, they're just sleeping, they're fucking homeless, dot to dot to dot, yeah, like, wake their fucking ass up. You that's know, true, like, every time there's a group, go shake them. Hey, group time. Like, mm-hmm, yeah, go do this. Right? Like,
well, you have to engage do, while yeah, you're here.
Engage them.
Yeah.
Tell them they have to engage.
Yeah.
I mean, you can't force them to engage. That's the thing. But go in there, do your assessments.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
yeah,
don't make it a pleasant place. I mean, yeah, some of them are legit suicidal.
Yeah.
But I think if you're going to go in there and you're just going to take up a bed because it's a little cold out or it's too hot outside, like, I don't know. I mean,
yeah,
I almost think that if I was in charge of that hospital, I would do away with adult unit,
mm-hmm,
and split adult unit not split it, but basically make it to where ICU West, if you wanted to have people who are homeless and suicidal or homeless, yeah, and they just wanted a bed, like, put them over there.
Mm-hmm.
Have ICU be for, like, fucking, have it co-ed, but have it be for, like, super fucking sick patients, unless they're, yeah, like, hypersexual or, like, a sex offender or something like, yeah, that. You know, like, I don't know. It irritates me, but at the same time, like, I know that's how it is in psych, and
yeah,
I think back in the day, maybe in the 70s and 80s, like, my mom, like, she worked in psych, and I think it was either, like, San Francisco or D.C.
Yeah.
One place, and she would talk about how, like, in the winter, people would come in and, like, talk to the TV, and, like, they would have to go out there and figure out if they were full of shit or not.
Oh, here, wow.
You come into Intermountain and you talk to the TV, you're going to ICU. Doesn't matter. Yeah, like, exactly. That's fucking money for us. Like,
yeah.
Oh,
like, we got at least 3 days while you're on yeah, hold, or if you came in on a fucking Friday.
Yeah, like that type, like, I don't know. But I think too, like, it's also like, you have to look at, like, who's bringing these people in. Like, are they walking to Intermountain themselves, or are they walking to St. Luke's downtown? Why does St. Luke's downtown feel that they need to come to Intermountain? Is it because they don't want to deal with a psych patient?
No, I don't think medical hospitals want to deal with a psych patient at all.
No.
No, they try to get them to us as fast as possible.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they don't. Like, when I was in the hospital last year,
they were telling me,
yeah, there was a psych patient, and they were, I was like, because I heard it out in the hallway, like, this person is being fucking crazy, this sounds like, you know, a patient in Intermountain. I was like, like, what's going on with this patient? They're like, oh, they're like code gray.
You had your guts cut open like 7 times, and you told the nurses that you wished you could go help.
Yeah, I wanted to go help because they didn't know what the fuck to do.
No, Chris could have totally.
And I could have, like, helped them, yeah, at St. Luke's here in Nampa or Meridian.
Are you at the St. Luke's in Nampa?
Yeah. I was at both of them, St. Luke's, Nampa, mostly, and Meridian. St. Luke's, most Nampa. Yeah. Yeah.
I just did my clinicals there.
No, did you? Yeah. And they were
just, like, don't like psych patients.
No, like, medical hospitals don't fucking like psych patients. No.
That shit pisses me off because it's just like, I don't know.
The thing that pisses me off about it is they don't give our ENR the full story
because
they want to get rid of that patient.
They completely fuck us. Like,
yeah.
So they don't tell you
literally
guys the
like
truth?
You could have somebody with a brain hemorrhage get sent from ICU to St. Luke's, and St. Luke's would call back and say the patient's coming back, they have a headache.
Whoa.
Like, yeah. That's how, like, they don't care.
Wow.
Yeah, they don't give a shit.
And to me, like, that's patients. So, like, that's so fucking unethical. Like, that's yeah. So, I mean, so I have a diagnosis. I have bipolar type 2. Like, I don't get psychotic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I have depression, so I get pretty fucking depressed. But the times that I've been in the ER for, like, concussions, migraines, or, like, when I was dealing with my stomach problems, literally, like, I'm treated like a fucking psych patient.
Wow.
That's really?
Like,
wow.
You tell them, like, the meds you're taking, oh, are you safe? Are you going to hurt yourself? It's just, oh, like,
God. Yeah.
Like, fuck off, dude. I just hit my head.
Like,
yeah.
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 Like,
they, you get the impression, and, like, I don't know. Like, it's I don't even want to go to... I won't go to St. Luke's ER because they have that in my chart.
Yeah.
And, like, all it takes is, like, one fucking bad word or one smart-ass comment to a fucking doctor or nurse, which I'm prone to do.
Like, you're a psych patient.
And then you're on a fucking hold.
Yeah.
When the commitment process starts. Wow. So I'm like, I'm not about that, yeah. You know? But, like, it's sad just how, like, that's how it is these days. And...
Even at Intermountain, I've seen just patients just asked to leave and they're put on a hold.
Yeah, like that shit too. It's just like, I don't know. I mean, I feel like there's not a lot of understanding.
Yeah.
I mean,
definitely,
there's not a lot of understanding towards a lot of people. And there's a lot of stuff based off of convenience, both at Intermountain, both at St. Luke's. I mean, just when I was doing my clinicals over there in the ER, and I mentioned to a couple of people, like, oh, yeah, like, I work at Intermountain, and they're just like, we could never do that kind of work. And I'm just like, it's really not that fucking hard. Like,
yeah.
It's too easy. That's why I'm here learning something new, is because it's too fucking easy.
Like, yeah. I mean, I would say, like, 80% of the time it's like any other healthcare job.
Yeah. It's like, you ever talk someone down from like throwing a chair at you? It's kind of like fucking like bass fishing, where like you get them on the line, like you see them and you get them on the line and you gotta reel them in. You
know?
It's kind of like that. Like, it's the same, it hits the same area of your brain. Like, it's it's kind of how I see it.
And that's how psychiatry relates to bass fishing, people. All right.
I like it.
Ooh, shit.
Oh,
all right, let's get out of here. Thank you, Ian.
Thank you so much.
You. Awesome. This was fun.
It's great conversation.
Yeah.
I'm Chris Adams.
I'm Wendy Mosier. What are you?
I'm signing out.
I'm signing off. You're Chris Adams. I'm Wendy Mosier. You know
you're a hashtagger.
What? Hashtag get toasted.
Stay toasted.
Boom.
Sweet. We're done.
That was awesome, dude.
Yeah.
Really,
thanks for having me on.
Thank
that. That's cool.